thanks, Andy, very much, and we're going to open it up to the floor for some questions. And while you all are making your way to the microphone, I've got a couple of things that I'd like to start off with the panelists. You know, we've talked today a little bit about boom-bust type of cycles that the industry's witnessed over the last few decades. We've lost a lot of talent. Folks are raiding each other's shops. And someone told me the other day that within 5 years, 50% of the SPE members will be retired. So we've got an aging workforce out there, and there's a big challenge out there to replace and rebuild. So both the drilling and service side of the industry is going to need tens of thousands of folks. So I'd like to open this up first to Jim, and then the rest of you can comment on this and chime in. How's Halliburton then going to position themselves for this future demand, especially as these unconventionals continue to drive us?
Well, it's a good question, Ted. And obviously, the demographics of the last several decades are creeping up on us, like you pointed out. I think we went through a 15 to 20 year period where we didn't hire anybody in this industry, and they're either all my age or they're 20 years younger, at least the bulk of our people. But this year we're looking to hire well over 11,000 people in North America, and I'd break those down into a frontline blue collar versus our professionals. When it comes to our frontline people, you know, today what's really has helped us, honestly, is the unemployment, the hovering around 9%. You know, we obviously recruit our people proximate to our operations, and that generally takes care of us. But this year we've had the benefit of unemployment. We've expanded beyond a lot of the traditional areas. We've gone up into the Rust Belt. We've gone to the East and West Coast, and again we've put a lot of people into the system. I think the key there is the quality of the recruiting and the level of the development and the training. Certainly we understand that we have to hire people that have an aptitude to learn, that have a good work discipline. And as Dave said earlier, we can hire a high school educated young person, put them into a training program and a developing program. They can end up moving up into middle management and even senior management and run multi-million-dollar businesses. With respect to the professionals, you know, traditionally we've recruited in the oil field states, Oklahoma, Louisiana, and Texas, and like our frontline people, we've expanded beyond those traditional recruiting areas, really to universities from coast to coast, and as well as recruiting to new universities, we've expanded those disciplines. We obviously hire, this year I think we'll hire close to 2,000 professionals, and that's from all engineering disciplines as well as the hard sciences, biology, chemistry, and physics. And again, it's about offering a developmental career that they can go to the bank with. You know, it seems like when I go out across the U.S., I'm always, it appears that we're the body shop to create a lot of our industry personnel, but at least at Halliburton, the people that we hire, they recognize if they have that on their resume that they have opportunities for advancement both internally and externally. So again, we certainly have to fill that gap, and we're reaching out to all disciplines.
And any other comments from the other panelists on that issue?
Just to add to that, certainly we find the same situation, entry-level people. There's no problem getting them into the force. The challenge is building drillers, and good drillers take about 5 years to build. So you know, some of the things that are being done, you know, building simulators to try and fast-track drillers up to speed, and you don't put a first-year driller onto a 2,000-horsepower rig. It's like putting a new pilot into a 747. So, you know, and you have to be, with all that, cognizant of safety and the environment while you're doing all that. And I would say that it only comes from the support from the operator, who understands that process and who asks questions of their service companies. Are you investing in training, et cetera, et cetera?
Good.
Yeah, one other comment. One of the things that we talked, when I talk about the regulations, one of the things that is a big aspect of the new regulations is personnel competency. So I think we've had, you know, much as Jim talked about training programs, but there's going to be another level of that, which is going to provide for certification. So using the 747, they're going to get their license. And one of the things that may, you know, one of the things that we see that may be a concern in the industry is once we certify somebody and certify them with a certification, it's a little bit like a CPA credential. It may actually increase the mobility in the industry. So I think it's something we're all going to have to watch as we go forward. It's one of those things that there's could be, as Jim Volker talked about, an unintended consequence.
Sure. Ted, I might just say, I mean, I think we're all doing a lot of training and we're all doing a lot of hiring. I think the real challenge, as already been mentioned, is when we do have the next downturn, and we will have another downturn in the cyclical business. I think that's the biggest challenge that each of us face, is how do you maintain those core people, quality people, through the downturns? And of course, I think we all, you know, every company is different, but I think we all just have to make commitments that, you know, you're not gonna cut your best folks.
That's
and
right.
you've got to hang on to people. And in our business, it's the lead tong hand, it's the motor hand, it's the newest guy that you've hired on the rig, unfortunately, is the guy that usually gets let go, and then you bump people back. But that still puts a lot of stress on a guy who was a rig manager who's now working as a driller or as a floor hand for 12 months or 18 months. It puts a lot of economic burden on them. So, you know, again, there's really, because we're public companies, you know, there's a lot of challenges. If you're a private company, it's a whole lot easier decision, but as a public company, it's tougher.
That's right. We've got a question from the floor.
So I'm Mike Ning. This is a question for Jim and Andy. John had a pretty detailed description of their rig build-out schedules and their targets. I think we all heard the number of, like, unstimulated backlog well bores that are out there. Can you all talk about your build-out rate on frac horsepower, how fast you're building it out, and what your targets are, and also how, you know, the international pressures for build-out there, too?
Yeah, I mean, basically, the simplest way to say it, on the Baker Hughes part, we bring a new fleet out now at the rate of about every 5 weeks. And so we're adding, you know, we'll add, rest this year, we'll add 300, you know, we'll, from here to the end of the year, we'll add another 300,000 horsepower, something like that. And we'll do, next year, we'll probably add, you know, we'll probably add somewhere around 1 million horsepower, maybe not, you know, a little less. That's North America. Internationally, the demand has been pretty moderate. Our hope is that if there is a retreat in the U.S., that we would redeploy this equipment. So we're building equipment that is redeployable, which is a little bit of a trick. But we're taking it with a sign at some point, as John talked. I hate to plan for the next downturn, that we would have equipment we could redeploy to markets such as Argentina or Europe or China or Saudi Arabia or wherever that may be. But that's kind of the rate we're at.
Yeah, and I would just add to that, as the largest pressure pumping company in the world, we took a contrarian view back in 2009. You know, we're a very reactive industry, and when things laid down prior to the advent of the liquids, everybody just quit manufacturing. Well, we didn't. We continued to build. We manufacture our own equipment. Our plan is flat out today. We have been building solid for 2 years, and just accelerated our capital plan in the next year to continue our build through 2012. You do bring up a good point on international. Even though it's slower to develop, we've been on several of the first stimulation treatments in Argentina and Poland, and it really takes every stick of horsepower in that country to complete one job. So as those develop, I just think the demand for horsepower is just going to get greater, and we will continue to build flat out. And the other effect is what I talked about earlier, and that's building a new generation of pumping equipment that you get more out of. We've got a new generation pump that's being prototyped as we talk that will get about 25% more horsepower out of and efficiency and longevity out of the current standardized horsepower that's out there today. So that's going to help us. And then one other thing as an industry we have to do, we have to become more prescriptive and surgical on these unconventionals. You know, right now it's just rock back and frack the heck out of it, because we treat these things as they're all the same. But really that reservoir quality varies. So we're going to have to become more prescriptive to where we can help our customers with their capital efficiency and be more prescriptive where we pump product. Use less product, less horsepower, and make better wells.
Right. Good. Another question from the floor.
Thank you, Ted. I'm Rob Bayless with Robert L. Bayless Producer. We're a much smaller company than was represented in your previous panel, but yet consuming all your services are very important to us. How does a smaller company continue to be relevant in your business model as a client?
And that's probably both, Rob, on the drilling and completion.
I think that's probably for everybody on the panel.
Good question.
You, Ted, but everybody else.
Good question. You want to start with the drilling side first, since that's the normal process of drilling a well?
Yeah, fair enough. We operate for about 600 different oil and gas companies around the world at any given time. You know, we appreciate the fact that a lot of small companies become big companies over time. So, you know, we do have quite a breadth of customer base.
We one metric is of the we've announced 77 new builds since January of 2010, and about 70% of those have been majors and large independents, and the rest are made up of, you know, the smaller operators. You know, I think the biggest challenge, it seems to me, is just from our experience, is the smaller guys being able to commit the amount of capital, and in some cases a term contract, in our case, in order to get a rig. But we do have a very large, small independent customer base.
Andy, Jim?
Yeah, I'll just add to that. We work for a lot of small customers, and the core of what I just talked about, alignment. The customers that aligned with us through the last several years, we took care of them. And now we're building equipment to take care of them. And yeah, there's a lot of juggling going on and moving people around, but people that aligned with us, we're going to take care of in both good times and bad.
Yeah, I'd say the same thing, is that particularly in the pressure pumping side of the business, we've stuck with people who stuck with us. So if it's unfortunate, we'd love to serve new customers a broader array, but our first priority is to take care of customers that we've been having a long-term relationship with. But I can tell you that, it's like Jim said, I think for us it's really a matter of alignment. I don't care whether a customer is big or small. Some small customers are by far the customers that we've had the most innovative relationships with.
No doubt. Any other questions from the floor? If not, I'd like to thank our four panelists today. They came from Texas, Calgary, Oklahoma, Denver. So thank you very much for coming today.
Thank you
all for coming to Investment Show.